joyful sound, and let it be heard. Proclaim to the ends of the earth, the Lord has freed his people. Alleluia. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, what I have done, what I have failed to do, my fault, my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie
eleison.
Christe
eleison.
Glory to God in the highest.
heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance we may always hold to in what we do, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. The children may come forward for the children's liturgy of the word. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Some who had come down from Judea were instructing the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the Mosaic practice, you cannot be saved." Because there arose no little dissension and debate by Paul and Barnabas with them, it was decided that Paul, Barnabas, and some of the others should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. The apostles and elders, in agreement with the whole church, decided to choose representatives and to send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. The ones chosen were Judas, who was called Barsabas, and Silas, leaders among the brothers. This is the letter delivered by them. The apostles and elders, your brothers, to the brothers in Antioch, Syria, and Sicilia of Gentile origin, greetings. Since we have heard that some of our number who went out without any mandate from us have upset you with their teachings and disturbed your peace of mind, we have with one accord decided to choose representatives and to send them to you along with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, who have dedicated their lives to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we are sending Judas and Silas, who will also convey the same message by the word of mouth. It is the decision of the Holy Spirit and of us not to place on you any burden beyond these necessities, namely, to abstain from meat sacrificed to idols, from blood, from meats of strangled animals, and from unlawful marriage. If you keep free of these, you will be doing what is right. Farewell. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Because you rule the peoples in equity, the nations on the earth you guide.
O God,
O God. May all the peoples praise you. May God bless us, and may all the ends of the earth fear him.
A reading from the book of Revelation. The angel took me in spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It gleamed with the splendor of God. Its radiance was like that of a precious stone, like jasper, clear as crystal. It had a massive high wall with 12 gates where 12 angels were stationed, and on which names were inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. There were 3 gates facing east, 3 north, 3 south, and 3 west. The wall of the city had 12 courses of stone as its foundation, on which were inscribed the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb. The city had no need for a sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gave it light, and its lamp was the Lamb. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever loves me will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and he will come to him and make our dwelling with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word you hear is not mine, but that of the Father who sent me. I have told you this while I am with you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I told you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give it to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. You heard me tell you, I am going away and I will come back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it happens, so when it happens, you may believe. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
One of the important numbers found in the Bible, especially in the New Testament, but also in the Old Testament, is the number 12. So in the book of Revelation today, we're told of this heavenly city with 12 courses of stones, 12 gates, 12 this, 12 that. Now, what is with 12? One of the important considerations for reading the scriptures, whenever there is a number, most of the time it's a symbolic thing. So what does 12 represent? Originally, 12 tribes of Israel, and then 12 apostles. 12 apostles means the church. Church was founded on the apostles. Now, let's look at the apostles. There are three or four lists of the names of the apostles. One question might be, who is the most popular of the 12 apostles today? From the point of view of devotion, it's not St. Peter. It's not St. John. It's one of the more obscure ones. I can prove this to you. Anybody who has subscribed to some Catholic publications, look on the classified page in the back, and this apostle's name is mentioned over and over again in thanksgiving for answers to prayer. Who is the apostle Saint Jude, called the patron of impossible cases or impossible causes? He's represented in statuary form, usually with a flame on his head, with a medal on his chest. Usually he's wearing green. I celebrated Mass at his altar at St. Peter's in Rome. St. Jude and St. Simon are associated, not necessarily because they worked together, but because their relics are together. So on October 28th is the feast day of St. Simon and Jude. This is not Simon Peter. This is another Simon in the 12 apostles. Now, my point today isn't so much to talk about St. Jude, but simply to say that it's a shame that what Jesus said in the gospel today answers a question asked by St. Jude, and Jude's question is not in here. They could have put it in. Now, what was the question that Jude asked Jesus? It's a brilliant question. It goes to show that intelligence is not necessarily knowing the right answers, it's asking the right questions. Here's what Jude asked Jesus. He said, "Lord, why not show yourself to the world rather than just to us," meaning the 12. Brilliant question. And the idea being, Jesus' life was coming to an end. And Jude was thinking, apparently, it'd be a terrible thing for everything Jesus started simply to be terminated because of Jesus' pending death. But here's what Jesus said, paraphrasing him a little bit.
basically said, don't worry about this, my friend. The Holy Spirit, he will come and allow people, all generations to come, to carry out my work, be my disciples, and so forth. And let me tell you, that has happened many times over. Now, if you go back to Jesus' life, he only lived to be 33. He was largely unknown outside of his homeland. In fact, one of his contemporary Roman historians from the first century mentioned Jesus, but he misspelled his name. I mean, Jesus was not famous at all. People who were in the audience to which Jesus spoke in the very narrow strip of geography, they heard him. Many were impressed by him. Many were befuddled, and some people hated him. But there were no telecommunication services. I mean, Jesus was not known worldwide, and so forth. So he dies at 33. Now today, I would contend that Jesus is probably the most well-known person who ever lived. The largest organization in the world is the Catholic Church. One-third of the world's people are Christians. What happened? To go from obscurity to the stature he has, the Holy Spirit did it. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will teach you all truth. He does. In the first century, where the 12 apostles, they heard Jesus speak, they ate with him and so forth, but they really didn't understand him. They didn't have catechisms that said, he's the Son of God who became man. Even his mother, who was the most open to him, didn't understand him completely. She knew he was from God because she was a virgin. But she had to treasure things in her heart about him because she had to learn about, who is this Jesus, my son? She learned. She became his greatest disciple, but the Holy Spirit was doing that. So in some ways, we're better off now than the 12 apostles were regarding our understanding of Jesus, knowing of him and knowing him and even relating to him. We can relate to Jesus on a personal level, and we should. That's what prayer is. And as members of his flock, this church that we have, meaning the Catholic Church, goes back to the 12 apostles. But if it weren't for the Holy Spirit, the church would have died with the death of the last apostle. Now, yesterday, I was at an ordination mass. The man ordained to the priesthood. That was yesterday. There were 9 men the Saturday before. This ordination took place at the Benedictine Monastery in Cleveland. This is an interesting story. The man who was ordained for a number of years was an executive in the financial world. Catholic man, layman. One day he was watching something on television. Undoubtedly it was a Catholic channel. And there was a bishop on the station who was talking to his people in a particular parish, who basically said, you know, I'm going to have to close up the parish. And here's the reason. We have the building, we have the people, we have the money, but we have no priest. We have nobody to send here. That man was watching that telecast. Something happened to him. And he decided, you know what? I think the Lord is calling me to be a priest. So he entered the Order of St. Benedict, and yesterday he was ordained a priest. I'm also happy to say that he's going to be helping us here, Immaculate Conception, as a weekend associate. Very, very grateful. Now we have 40,000 priests in the U.S., 400,000 in the world. How is it that we have any priests? the Holy Spirit. How is it that we have any vocations to anything? Holy Spirit. Disciples, Holy Spirit. What about the New Testament? Jesus never said, I want you to write 27 books, four of them are Gospels. He never said it. How do we have it? The Holy Spirit and the church. It's a blessing that we live in the day in which we live. Now, some of you, I'm sure, saw the fire, the terrible fire of Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris on YouTube or on television. I've been there a number of times over the years. Magnificent. The landscape of Europe is dotted with beautiful cathedrals. The idea was to replicate something of the heavenly city in art and architecture, living, so to speak, or I should say, monuments in stone to our faith. But there's something more to this. They're not just buildings. A church is not just a building. It is a building. It's what goes on in the church and what dwells in the church. Dear Lord, body and blood. Now before the priest consecrates the elements at Mass, let your spirit come upon these gifts, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, body and blood of Jesus, the church, the Mass, life, grace, holiness. God is working even today. Now, it's interesting that Notre Dame took 200 years to build. And what we're talking about, people from, you know, the stained glass, artisans, woodworkers, stonemasons. And most of the people who built that structure never saw the finished product, never, because it took 200 years. What was motivating them? Their faith, the influence of the Holy Spirit. So the Lord is active today, bringing people to faith, supporting us, bringing about vocations, making it possible for us to have all of the sacraments. We must be grateful. And I would urge everybody, have a devotion to the Holy Spirit. Pray to him every day, glorify him. Come, Holy Ghost, fill the hearts of thy faithful and kindle in them the fire of thy love. You can take the song and use the words, the lyrics, as a prayer. And then, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Use your own words. But the Holy Spirit makes it possible for us to recognize God as our Father, believe in Jesus, and to live as disciples. Ultimately, he will take us to heaven, because we can't get there left to our own devices.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, true God of true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, whom all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate in the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. Rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, judge living and the dead. Kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son, adored, glorified, spoken, prophets. I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess from baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and look forward to resurrection of the dead, and life of the world to come. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let us now bring to our Father the following prayers.
For the church throughout the world, especially in areas affected by war or persecution, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders of nations that are at war, that they may find a way to peace and avoid further bloodshed, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the men newly ordained to the diaconate and for the 10 men recently ordained to the priesthood for service in our diocese, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we allow ourselves to be guided by the influence of the Holy Spirit through prayer, study, and participation in the life of the church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the repose of our nation's war dead, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Roseanne Crowfoot, Richard Carroll.
The sick.
Oh, I'm sorry, the sick. For those who are sick, Roseanne Crowfoot, Richard Carroll, Richard Nichols, and those who are listed in the bulletin, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those who have died, especially Dixie Barron, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us into your church. Please help us to remain faithful by each of us offering himself in and through your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
I
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offering, so that, purified by your graciousness, that we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Just our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of all to fulfillment in the reality of the cross, and by commending himself to you for our salvation, showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Sending down your spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Until you come.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who've pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
being for me a testimony of body and remedy.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Today we have a First Communion. Sergio Barone will be coming up, so please don't come up the aisle until he's made his First Communion.
Yeah.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
This afternoon from 2 to 5, join members of our parish community to watch a film which will be shown called I Am Gabriel. It's in the parish center, and then tomorrow at 9 o'clock a.m. we have Mass. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And all the